Galatians were, they were kind of outcasts in the Roman Empire. We don't even know exactly which part of Galatia the Roman Empire kind of labeled different areas Galatia at different times. In the same way that, for example, if you were to be standing in what we call Arkansas in 1810, you would count yourself part of Louisiana, because it was all part of the Louisiana Purchase. But we are fairly certain that we have, you know, gotten better than that, and we're now Arkansas, and we are not part of Louisiana. But yet, historically speaking, you could argue that this is, you know, historically at one point, this would have been referred to as Louisiana. Historically, this area was once claimed by the French, by the Spanish, by the British, and all at the same time, if there were the Quapaw and the various and sundry other Native American tribes that lived here and didn't really care who claimed to the land. They lived on it, and it was theirs. And so Galatia kind of went through some phases where it kind of grew and shrank, and if I had a great big map, I could point to all that for you and really bore you to tears with it. But the Galatians were kind of the backwards. They weren't quite considered as cultured and as refined as the Romans. Galatia, this is why I picked, you know, that Galatia, you know, was not unlike Arkansas and Louisiana. You know, they're kind of those, you know, they were kind of the hillbilly cousins in the Roman Empire. They weren't widely accepted. And in fact, one of the things that the Galatians wanted to be was counted and treated as equals by their educated, proper fellow Roman citizens, because Galatians would go into battle with the Romans because they were Roman subjects, and they fight just as hard or harder. They were still a part of the empire. They paid the same taxes, and yet, you know, it's the Galatians that when they would, you know, they'd come to the feasts and such in Rome and in other places, the civilized places, they said, oh, well, you don't mind them. They're from Galatia. This is one of the reasons that as you have read through Galatians, Paul has made such a big deal about citizenship. Your citizenship being in heaven and why it doesn't matter. This is why he gets into there's neither Jew nor Greek. You know, all these things, in chapter 3, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free man, male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you're Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise. He's making the point that quit worrying about whether people count you as Galatians, whether people count you as good enough. And this is also why in Galatians 3:1, when he's been talking to them and he gets a little stern with them about casting aside the gospel to fall into legalism, he says, you foolish Galatians. A very simple way to translate that is that Paul is really writing to them saying, you dumb rednecks, what are you thinking? That's really what he's saying. If you hear that, if I were to stand up in front of you all and say that to you, which I won't because I'm not that mean to you and you don't deserve it like the Galatians did, as far as I can tell. But that's basically what he's saying. He's saying, y'all are going backwards anyway. You're casting aside God's truth to try to be accepted, but because you're casting it aside, you're actually going backwards. You're doing all this to chase other people's approval, and because of it, you're going backwards and trying to be approved by God. Don't do it. So we get through all this, and he talks about freedom in Christ and why that matters, and then we get to Galatians chapter 6, beginning with verse 1. Brethren, even if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted. It's always easy for us to find fault, to find things that aren't right. It's very easy for us to do that, and it's very easy for us to say, well, you know, I'm a spiritual person, I'm going to help this other person out. Now, Paul is not talking here about people that are the difference between somebody who is being faithful to their marriage vows being faithful to their vows not to rob banks for a living, being faithful to keep the commandments, and that person looking at someone who is robbing a bank to support their drug habit, and you know, the three people that they're having an affair with outside of marriage, and saying, you know, hey, look, you know, be careful as you look at this person and don't be judgmental. He's not talking about these cases that are very clear cut, that this is wrong, and as a church, we have to stand up and say, this is wrong, and you need to correct that, because if you're going to do what's wrong, you cannot be a functioning member of Christian community, because you're going to continue to live in sin, you're going to bring division and disgrace upon the name of Christ. And a lot of times we'll see people want to use this as kind of a shield when they're in obvious sin. And that's not what Paul's talking about. Paul's talking about the people who kind of got their nose a little bit up in the air about the fact that, well, I see you missed church last Sunday night. You know, those of us that were spiritual were here. And he's pointing out that, you know, there are some things that may or may not be a big deal. And if they are, some of these, if they are important, like, ooh, you missed church Sunday night. Then if you think you're spiritual enough to be the person telling folks what to do, keep in mind your responsibility is to restore them in a spirit of gentleness, not lord it over them in a spirit of how important and how special you are. Oh, I looked at the plate today, and I can see that some of you forgot to bring as much as you were supposed to bring at offering time. Let's fix that. Not that kind of nonsense, but instead to restore in a spirit of gentleness, to look at people and say, how can I help you? Because it seems like, you know, are you struggling with this? How can we help you with this? And this is something that we as a church and as church people, we have to work on. Because it's real easy, for example, to stand up and say, you know what, some of you parents will have to straighten up because I don't like the way you're parenting. And that may be true. You may be parenting wrong. Who knows? I may be parenting wrong. No comments. Entire pew right there. None of the five of y'all to offer anything on that. I may be parenting wrong. But there is a way to address that with a spirit of gentleness than to walk up to somebody and say, I can't believe you did that. I can't believe you let them have two cookies. Or, I can't believe you didn't let them have any cookies. Well, you know what? There's gentleness. And that needs to come. And if you are spiritual enough, and if you are mature enough and think yourself mature enough to correct others, then you should be mature enough to handle it with a spirit of gentleness and humility. You don't just get mature enough to get to boss people around. You have to get mature enough to be able to lead people and to guide them with a spirit of gentleness. Those two things have to come together. Because Jesus pointed out to us that we're not supposed to lord it over one another. So, if somebody is caught in a trespass and a difficulty, restore them with gentleness. Notice the word restore. There are times that people, because of sin, because of difficulty, because they have chosen to disobey what God has told them to do, it is necessary that the church, as the body of Christ, say, you know, we've got to kind of push you out of leadership. There are things that you can do in terms of choosing to sin that should cause the church, for example, say, you can't teach Sunday school till you get this right. You can't be a deacon until you get this right. You can't be the preacher until you have gotten this right and shown over a period of time that you are willing and capable of serving in humility without standing up in front and having everybody look at you all the time. Those things occur. But the goal should always be that we want to see people restored to fellowship within the body of Christ. or desire to see somebody pitched out the door on their ear, never to return. Now, does that mean that we don't set conditions? There are times that you set a condition on them. If he could keep showing up to church intoxicated every Sunday, you put him out and say, don't come back till you come back sober. You make it that simple. And I'm picking on the deacons, but just because they're here and it's fun. But that's just, I'm picking a ridiculous example so that you all don't, nobody thinks I'm trying to sideline, you know, well, y'all really know who I'm talking about, but I'm not going to name names. Y'all know that none of our deacons show up to church having had too much to drink. We'll talk about the rest later. But, you know, that type of, you know, y'all know that doesn't occur, but let's take that as an example. That you would say, don't, you can't, you cannot continue to be a deacon if you're going to show up at church intoxicated. In fact, you can't come back to this building when you have obviously been drinking. That's not a barrier to restoration. That is a choice before that person. Do you want to be restored? You've got to change your behavior because your behavior is disruptive to what the church is doing. It's the same thing when you go back into Galatians chapter 2 when Peter decides he doesn't want to eat with Gentiles anymore and Paul calls him on it and says, how can you do this? Can you imagine walking into church and looking around next time, Wednesday night when we have our Thanksgiving breakfast? You walk in and say, you know what? I don't think I'm going to eat with anybody that's related to Gary Stone anymore. First of all, you just about wiped out the entire church. Except for maybe Miss Jerry. You're not related to Mr. Gary. I don't think. You got to see Miss Jerry. This is the only person left you can eat with. Everybody else by marriage, I think, is somehow connected. Once it all spreads out, that'd be ridiculous. And if that became your attitude, well, I don't want to sit next to or talk to anybody that's related to Gary ever again. We'd have to look at you and say, you know, you got to get over that to be a part of this church. Because we're not going to build that type of division into this church. And you'll have to make a choice. You can either come and be okay being around the relatives of Gary Stone, or you could not come. Because we can't put all of Gary's relatives out. Wouldn't be enough folks left. No offense to Miss Jerry, I'd have church just for you, but I think you'd get tired of it. I think you'd feel picked on. But that's what Peter was doing. Hey, I'm not going to eat with anybody from that family over there. All of that family. All of that extended family. And Paul says, we can't do this. We're going to have fellowship. You've got to change your attitude. You have to change your behavior that reflects this attitude. And that's what it took for there to be restoration. We move on. Bear one another's burdens and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. We should help one another. Part of the problem in Galatia was this. Folks were looking at people saying, it looks like you're having trouble getting this done in a way that honors God. Yeah, tough luck for you. Wait a minute, you can help. If you can help somebody to be able to walk closer with Jesus, instead of pulling back and saying, well, it's a shame you keep tripping and falling over that step out there. Instead of picking on Knox, you seem to trip and fall right there. You know, we could smooth the carpet out for him. Y'all could take out that hump the poor guy keeps tripping over. Bear one another's burdens. Help one another out. This is why verse 20 continues. He finishes that up with, look to yourself to make sure that you don't fall into the same thing. Because we work together. Scripture knows nothing of this idea that I look at you and say, go fix your problem. Call me when you get done. If anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work. But then you'll have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone and not in regard to one another. If you have anything to boast about, it needs to be this. Not that you're better than somebody else, but that you're doing the best that you can. And that's not really a boast. I doing the best that the Lord allows. This goes back to where Paul talks about, I'll boast in Christ Jesus and not in myself. Because we know that without Him, we don't really get anything done. Each one will bear his own load. You're going to take the responsibility. The one who is taught the word is to share all good things with the one who teaches. Now, I've heard that passage preached as, you know, pointing out that it's a good idea to pay your preacher, and that, I don't disagree. But more than that, share the good things. Hey, I heard this from you in a sermon 6 months ago, and today I realized how that helps my life. Share the good things that happened. Share the good things that you learn in Sunday school, how they affect your life. Share those with your Sunday school teacher. Share those good things. Because your Sunday school teacher hears about it when your Sunday school classroom is too hot, when it's too cold, when the chairs aren't comfortable, when something starts late, when the bulletins aren't there, when the books aren't right, when this isn't right. We tell our Sunday school teachers all the things that are going wrong on Sunday morning. You come in, this went wrong and that went wrong. Your Sunday school teacher hears all that bad, all that negative. Tell your Sunday school teacher some good things that you gather from what they teach you. You might be amazed how that works and how that helps. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, this he will also reap. Y'all know this. You go put rice seed in the ground, it's not going to come up wheat. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. The one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. Doing good for others, showing compassion. This comes back to that faith, hope, and love thing. In due time, if we show love, if we sow that, and sow compassion, if we do that in obedience, having faith that it will have a result, then eventually that hope will come back. And we'll reap what we've sown. We'll reap the good things that we want to have, whether it be growth in our own lives, growth by seeing people come to the kingdom and become followers of Christ, or simply growth by stepping off into eternity and being met and being told, well done, my good and faithful servant. So then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith. Notice that Paul does cut a distinction here between those who are in the church and those who are out of the church. But he doesn't say, do bad to the people out of the church, but do good to the people that are in the church. That's not what he tells us to do. He says, let's do good to everybody, but let's especially make sure that we do good for the household of faith. In other words, the first thing that we do is, yes, we make sure that we're all taken care of. We also look to the rest of the world. But beyond that, notice it says, while we can, while we have opportunity, let us do good. While we can. Because a time is coming that you may not be able to. While you can, do good for somebody. While you can. If you can get up in the morning and do good for somebody, then do it. If you can get up, if you can say, you know, I can be a Sunday school teacher. I can do this to serve others. I can do this to help the church. I can do this to spread the gospel. While you can, do it. While you can, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Because if you don't, there may come a day that they won't listen to you do it. While we can, parents, raise up your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, because someday they'll be a smart mouth preacher and I don't think they can listen to you anymore anyway. Actually, one of the things that you learn is to go back to listen to what your father used to say. But while you can, so often we put off till tomorrow the good stuff that we could do today. And in fact, you go back to the first verse in Galatians 6, and you see that they had a problem in that there were people in the church who were putting off doing good for one another so that they could take the time to criticize. The opportunity, let's do good instead of criticizing. So do good, build up, strengthen. Find people to do good things for. Make that effort. Put in that time. Why? Because we reap what we sow. And if we sow walking in obedience to God and strengthening the family of faith, then you know one of the things that we'll reap? When those times come that we need, those folks will be there. When those times come that somebody comes along and they look at you and they say, you know, I just can't believe what you're telling me that about Jesus and his love for me and how he's made it possible for me to be a part of the household of faith, you'll be able to say, look, why don't you come and see? First two things we see of evangelism in Scripture in the New Testament is where John points at Jesus and says, behold the Lamb of God. And the next thing that we see is Andrew saying, come and see. Jesus saying, come and see. And the more we build one another up, we have something that's worth coming and seeing, because we can go and tell, which we were told to do. And we can say to people, come, see what this is about. I can tell you about Jesus, but I've got a family of faith. I've got a household of faith that can show you even better. Those are things worth doing. Paul said so, as he was inspired. He, in fact, wrote it with his own extra-large handwriting. I love verse 11. See with what large letters I am writing to you with my own hand. We could spend hours on what that probably means, but realize Paul says, this is a big deal. I wrote it big so that you could see it. I want you to get this. Do what we can while we can do it. Because that time comes when that opportunity is lost and we can't ever get it back. Let's pray for you. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. We pray, Lord, that you'll help us this week to do good while we have that opportunity. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.